Okay, are we ready?
Yep.
Welcome to the October 19th regular meeting of the Fayette County Commission. This morning, the commissioners and I tested for the general election with county clerk and members from each party. Well, we represented the Republican Party and we had represented the Democratic Party. So now we're started. Clerk Holly, could you lead us in the pledge of allegiance?
Yep. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic, and one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Personal property and real estate. Now, I want to point out something on this real estate. It looks really bad. But from here down to the back of it, are all minimum assessments. It was an oil and gas company. We got double assessed on a bunch of really small cracks. So all of those together, that you know, these big ones probably would.
You're making me work. Okay. We have a refund for $16.70. I mean, we approve it.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. I have an exoneration for real property that is presented this morning.
That one's a speed problem.
Okay, so I'll make a motion of exoneration.
A second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, I'll make a motion to approve the personal property exoneration.
All those in favor?
Aye. Guys, I was running late this morning, so I'll have to do it. Copy the very thing, I'll bring it back.
Oh, thank you.
All right. I'll bring these back.
All right. Second half of payroll. What's the payroll?
1028.
Make a motion to approve second half payroll. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Vouchers and invoices.
The only thing I was looking for is the quarterly transfer for the library and the CDB. So that's fine. There was one for being released with Janetti.
Janetti.
For love related. $24,000.
I'll make a motion to approve the vouchers and invoices.
My second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, we don't have minutes. State settlements. Oh, I move away for state settlements.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
There was one other voucher and invoice that was Fayetteville Fire Department. You brought them here. I looked over and Tom looked over and I didn't know he wanted to sign them. So if y'all just approve those, Gia will issue the check.
And you went over them and there was no.
Tom looked at them too. So.
Yeah, this is the only way it's supposed to.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'll make a motion to approve the Fayetteville Fire Department's invoice.
Second.
All those in favor?
It looks really good.
Yeah,
yeah, that's
what you should.
We gotta see if we can get copies of this from them to do the format.
I think it's attached to the blank conference.
Yeah.
The levy.
Oh, is it? So yeah,
it's one of the exhibits. Was it like F or G or something?
Am I a levy coordinator or amount approved?
Amount approved.
Or,
yeah,
where am I?
Where?
One of these are you probably.
I can sign one. And you just pick one, I'll sign one. Well, Tom, I don't remember the title of the
I'm just going to hand it to Tom. Okay.
So the first thing on there is after the opioid settlement, and Anthony said he was going on that.
Okay, so I move that we postpone that to when, Anthony?
Next meeting should be fine.
November 2nd?
Yeah, that should be fine.
Yeah. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
PSD funding. I want to skip that one. Let's go to Corporal Cypress.
I got that. You want to do it?
Yeah.
Michael has a hearing. This is the grant we put in for Fort Security Grant. We were approved, or basically approved, $43,346 to sign up for paper so we can update all of our cameras or alarms and stuff. We've been struggling with stuff breaking down, so we got the grant for $43,000. To get the whole amount we asked for, but this was all the stuff we need to do. So I appreciate it.
I move we approve.
Mm-hmm.
All those in favor?
Aye.
I think you leave it up here.
And then the next one was a records management grant. Amy, one of you done all the work you have?
Yeah, and once you decide your priority list, I'll type it up and put the document that happens to be assigned. There are three submissions for records management grants this time. The first in your packet was from the Sheriff's Department for, I believe it's $2,700 for scanners. The second one was from County Clerk for new map cabinets, $4,896.99. And the tax office is asking for a Synology device that would help with digitizing all of their documents for ease of retrieval and storage. And that's for $3,570. So total, we're only asking, and we can submit three applications to see the prioritize these. And it's under $12,000 we're asking for in grant. And so we would do a, it's a, I think that match.
Mm-hmm.
So, minimal match to possibly take care of three different offices. You just need to prioritize the different projects so that we can put them on, and they'll either, and I've seen it before where we prioritize it and they still skip around and do it, but they want to see how we do it. So do you want to suggest?
I think I would prioritize the tax office, the digital storage,
mm-hmm.
to eliminate paper.
Mm-hmm.
I would make that first. The other two was,
and what were the other two again?
Map cabinets, new map cabinets, flat map storage in the county clerk's office, and then basically the same that we got for county commission last year, scanners to help the sheriff's office authenticate their documents.
I would put that on second.
I talked to the grant people down there, two commissioners, and they got the money. They said, get them in, and probably can offer it.
Exactly. And we're asking, I think the last time we asked for something for circuit clerk, it was about the the whole project was about what we're asking for all three projects. And it was funded along with another one. Mm-hmm. So they're usually good enough.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I move that we approve the grant because it's application. Mm-hmm. Grant applications in the order we said. So that is the tax office, sheriff's, and Elmwood.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So we have next is the letter from the old office of reference to that one. So Teresa from Dayreport and I interviewed three people. Two people come up as the top two candidates, and then I asked Allison to talk to the top candidate for a second opinion, and she agrees Dan would be the best choice. He has new ideas. He already knows all the policies. He told me stuff I didn't know because I'm not familiar with border control. So
I think he has potential to grow within the organization as we have some key personnel retiring in the next couple of years and that sort of thing. He had researched the beautification committee and read minutes about the status of it and all kinds of things. I was very impressed.
You read our ordinances?
Yes.
Yeah. Totally agree 100%.
It was really impressive. So what's the salary you recommend, Ruth?
Well, the range was 30 to 35. I thought about starting on the low end and after 6 months, if he would love that, moving up to the high.
Low end being right at 30. Mm-hmm. Okay, and what's the, I know he told me he had to give 2 weeks notice if you were selected.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, I can contact him. Or if we go on a break,
maybe call them during a break and we can do an effective date after that.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So I'll just go ahead and wait till we get an effective date and we'll vote on that.
Well, we have a.
We probably need to vote to hire him. I move that we go ahead and hire Dan, the border control officer position.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
And then there a petition to appoint the sheriff as administrator of the Billy Ray Vance estate. Michelle, want to talk more?
Well, the sheriff gets him if there's nobody
right
to take care of it. He's a conservator, so I'll go ahead and move that we approve that.
Yeah.
All those in favor?
Aye.
It's 9:14. Do you want to go ahead and
yeah, we'll go back to the agenda. Hey, Sheriff, you're up. Cruisers.
You're trying to cruise up.
Tom's name is spelled wrong on there. So.
I noticed that.
Good morning, Commissioner. Coming to you guys again, back in budget, you say come back throughout the year. We'll be able to purchase some cruisers. I am getting ready to hire two new deputies starting the 31st of this month. Then I will hire two more and I still be down two. But I'm going to be hiring four people. Long story short, I talked to the department the other day, Wayne, and I said, how many spares do we have? He said three, but they're all on the road for recalls or these new cars. If something happened to transmission, it was out of the quack for 8 months, 9 months. So I'm asking the county commission if there's any possible way that we can purchase some vehicles. Now, when I got this information together and sent out an email, there was one place in the whole United States that had 10 cruisers. Called this morning, or Monday, they had three left. Called this morning, they had one left. And that's the price I've got. Their price, as a matter of fact, are lower than the state bid, because the state bid is going to go up anywhere from $4,000 to $7,000 this new year. They just haven't came out with it. The price of the Ford Interceptor is what we found was $37,190.25. To put emergency into it, that's everything inside that they need, like siren, cages, all that stuff, is $13,527.15. And then the Kenwood radio, also there's different levels, and we have to have the second level tier two now, as well as the siren. It went up to 1,000 or $1,448.86. So a completed outfitted cruiser at this price was $52,165.58. And there's just one. So either I can call him and say, put it off to a seven, we'll get it, or we just try to find some more. But the chief made some phone calls after we found out that he just had one left. There's none. I mean, I'm going to keep searching, but the price we have right now is $52,165.48 for one cruiser. And that has all the equipment in it, strike, new radio in it. And it might go down because if I talk to the park, and one of the big ones down there that has a radio in it, taken out, that's going to be trashed. And we use that. But most of them are the old Motorola and not they are not the kids. So there you have it. Mm-hmm.
Well, we have
to build in extra. I move we approve the purchase of the one cruiser with the lighting and the radio.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Hey, Mike. How close are you being done with the report that I requested?
That was a lot harder than what the thoughts kind of deal with the usual deal, but Michael and I have been both.
All right, thank you.
Can you sign this? Did you not put the one purchase and that was the 371925? I got it sitting back.
And who is this at? Where's the people in?
Indiana.
So will they move it here, or do you guys have to go and get it?
Right. We're gonna go get it.
Yeah, they'll probably charge a few $100 if you want it delivered. Mm-hmm. All right. So anybody need a break?
I don't need a break.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, so we're going to move on to 9:30. Rich, do you want to go back to Exhibit A? Okay, I don't know if we're ready for number seven yet. Michael was going to call John Stone and let us know. I'm going to text him. He's like, yeah, I'm sure.
What's that?
I have a chart from Danny's PSC of all I have.
No, I don't. It's the same presentation that you made 2 weeks ago. However, on number 10, I received some information that I haven't been able to share yet with the two other commissioners. We need to put that on hold.
Okay.
For a board member for all right, PSD.
Let's move on to Gig Ready. We don't have an answer on the two. Yeah. So with regard to Gig Ready, this was one from last week. This is our broadband funding. Gig Ready is the Economic Development Secretary's program for getting broadband throughout the state, and we applied for help with that. We're at the planning stages where a lot of people are already executing and digging, and they put us together with Nicholas County, Anstead, and Montgomery to come up with some ideas about where we want to put in broadband. And we're looking at the major routes at about 60. Yeah. We're looking at 19 between Nicholas and Raleigh. We're looking at Route 612, but we had to pick a contractor, basically an engineer, to advise us on it and do a study on it, and then we had to pick an internet service provider. And the other commissioners and a group that we put together informally took a look at all the applications, narrowed it down to two contractors and two internet service providers. Commissioner Brenneman in the meeting last week or 2 weeks ago had some additional questions, so we postponed making a selection into this week. I participated in the second set of interviews since I wasn't able to participate in the first, and I thought there was going to be some disagreement between my colleagues, and I was going to have to, you know, be a deciding vote. But I do think we need to get that out there. So the finalists for the internet service provider was Gigabeam. So it was Gigabeam and CityNet. They were very close, but Gigabeam was able to offer more affordable, tailored packages to our constituents rather than kind of a one-size-fits-all, because here one-size doesn't fit all. We want all make the same amount of money or have the same needs. So anyway, I move that we choose Gigabeam as the internet service provider for that Gig Ready project.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, and with regard to the contractors, we brought Thompson and Litton back in, and we also brought our local S&S engineering firms in. This wasn't a, none of it was a formal selection. We were information gathering, and now we are doing the selecting, and I'm not sure whether anybody's mind was changed or anything, but I'm going to move that we select S&S as our contractor.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
I'm relieved. Okay. So
the next thing I think should be fairly quick is
putting
out for proposals or bids for the annex roof repair because the roof's leaking. Mm-hmm. Only got an estimate. This one in March.
Okay.
The lowest was 38, the highest was 42, but I'm sure it'll be a lot more than that now.
We'll have more bids.
Yeah.
So I move that we advertise for bids for the roof repair at the annex.
Yeah.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Don, you said we're going to postpone number 10?
Yes. So I'll make a motion to postpone number 10 until November 2nd. Yeah.
All those in favor?
Aye.
That leaves Davies and the trip.
Now, I thought we were going to try to, is Region 4 on the line?
I can't see.
Leslie or?
I think what we were waiting for is to see if Region 4 had any other sources of funding. Like there had to be some kind of funding that we understood. If it's not going to be, let's contribute to a project that's not funded. Match businesses.
Leslie, got in for a minute.
Unmute her. Okay.
Good morning.
Hey, good morning. So, what do you think about Danny's lessons? Do they have other funding options put together yet?
The purpose of the Danny's request was, you know, they had come to the commission to ask for some assistance with some design funding. We do not have any other design funding for them at this time.
What was the amount there? Because I don't think anybody gave us an amount. We had this, you know, $1 million+ estimate of what the work might cost.
We did email a draft budget to Amy, and she did acknowledge receipt.
That looks like a spreadsheet. It's...
I want to pull that up, but I guess I was just focused on the big dollar signs.
So if you'll look there in the column that says Fayette County Commission.
So where on the spreadsheet is the design?
Okay, so if you look over towards the right on that draft budget, you'll see a column that's labeled Fayette County Commission.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be the design funding that they need to get this project really underway.
And is this, does this include what we've requested as far as the cost to, as they're designing it, to put broadband conduit in?
I believe that would be a question for their engineer, and I do not have that answer.
Who is the engineer?
That's E.L. Robinson Engineering.
Yeah. I really feel that we need to talk to all the contractors that are doing PSV work, make them aware of what you're going to request, the lines in, and see what kind of price, and make sure they include it when they're doing that. But maybe broken out to the side, so that, you know.
So right now we're looking at $25,000 for 10-year report. On this.
I think that request was for $190,000. If you look down to the bottom, if you go down to the bottom of that column.
I don't think, I'm not prepared to submit $190,000. The study and report.
I'll do the study and report.
All right, so I move that we allocate $25,000 for the study and report for the Danese PSV Maplewood Waterline Upgrade Project. And what I'd like to see is, Leslie, if you could circle back with them and just make sure that they know that we want the engineers to incorporate, you know, put conduit in the ground. If that's going to increase the cost of the study, then they just need to circle back with us.
Okay, we can do that.
Thank you. So I move that we allocate $25,000.
That's it.
All those in favor? Aye. All right. We're almost at 9:30.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
except for
two.
And we need to circle back to where we can follow over. So, with regard to the animal shelter, this item is on the agenda because the commission put out a request for proposals to for people to submit to run our animal shelter. And we received one proposal, and it was from a nonprofit that is called the Fayette County Humane Society, Fayette County, West Virginia Humane Society, new organization made up of individuals who previously worked at our animal shelter and left for various reasons. That's the only proposal we received. We did not receive one from the River Humane Society, which indicated the meat was no longer interested in running the shelter. So, with that said, I move that we approve the proposal that we received from Fayette County Humane Society to run the shelter.
That's it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Now that said, I think we need to do a couple of things to get things going. The proposal said that we would need 6 employees because we're probably going to have to fly by the seat of our pants for a little while. I'm going to move that we, Ruth, what is the salary amount we could afford to pay these?
Okay, we already have it budgeted. It was $125 or $130 left. So whatever the current salaries are, you could probably meet without an issue. I don't know what those salaries are.
Well, let's do it now, and then whoever they appoint as their director can come back and ask for raises. I know it's fewer employees than they have now, mm-hmm. So if they're going to want to increase those salaries, I'm open to that. But so I move that we approve the hire of 6 temporary employees until the organization gets going and pay them at their current salaries, which I'd asked, and I understand them to be maybe $10 or $11 an hour. I'm not sure exactly, but whatever their current salaries are.
Yeah.
All those in favor?
Aye.
They're going to need a spending budget. And you said we have 125 to 130. Anybody have an idea about what you want
to? Yes, I would like to make a motion. Okay. I'd like to make a motion to approve Ruth to spend up to $75,000 to get this new organization up and running with bowls, blankets, things that's necessary that Nuva will be taken with them.
That's it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And I had a note to myself, but I think we ought to have a transition team to do this. We have an employee who worked in the county already, Kevin Walker, who ran a shelter in Mercer County. I'd like, if you guys agree, to appoint Kevin on the transition team. Also, Sheriff, if you don't mind, our animal control officer, Michelle, when she's better. Please. The new organization could designate its own members. Also, we've reached out to the Day Report Center to see if we could have a Day Report Center rep on there, because the Day Report Center is going to be contributing labor. So we'll leave that to the director of the Day Report Center to decide who that individual is going to be. And then I reached out to the New River Humane Society yesterday evening, I think it was, and it nominated three people to be on the transition team. I'm not sure we need three, but you know, we'll go with that unless things start to become unwieldy. I'm having trouble pulling up the image this morning. Do you have it? Who are the names? It was Sherry.
Sherry
Spilker. Spilker,
I think. Oh, there's two Sherry. Sherry McDaniel and Kyle Taylor. Oh, is it the same person? It said me or myself, Sherry McDaniel, but it's two people.
It's just two people? Okay. I think they're good. All right. So, Sherry. And Kylan Price. So you guys agree with the transition team. So I move we create a transition team to help facilitate the transfer of management of the animal shelter. And for the record, there's no intention of changing it. We want to keep it no kill. So for anybody who's asking or worrying, you know, we're not going to start putting down animals. We're hope to run it in the same spirit as the prior, and as far as the no-kill shelter is concerned.
And I'll still make the same offer to New River once they get established. If they run into some farm animals that are too large,
To Fayette?
Well, I'll still work with both. Okay. Yeah, I'll work with both. If they still run into some animals that are too large for them to handle, then give me a call.
Okay. All right, so do we already take care of the transition team vote?
No.
So I move we create a transition team as I laid out.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
You want to say anything about the no-kill also?
I want to say I think we need to do a press release on the animal shelter staying open.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe being open the house once they get the other after the other come in to run. To know that we're not doing away with the animal shelter.
Right.
That's what we've been said. We're doing away with it. We're going to be killed forever. We've never done that. So I think there's a press release after today, somebody has a bright press release regarding that. That we're presenting.
And when you get it to me, do we all agree we want to ensure press release?
Yes.
So if I circulate the content, you guys can look at it and we'll just. Okay.
And the people who work there or currently working there, they do really, I mean, they work hard. So
Yeah, and it's my understanding that that the people taking it over intend to extend offers to existing employees, or at least that's what they said.
What they'd like to do.
Richard, I have a question for you. I mean, when does all this take effect immediately? Does the other organization have to be gone, or is it going to be, you know, I don't want my deputy to get into something that if it would happen, you know, the new group goes down, there's some people from the other organization there, and then who's what?
They're they have a vacating date. So we had extended their notice until November 6th.
So November 6th.
Right. So this transition team, both sets of parties are on the transition teams. So they're going to work together to, I know we received, for example, we received a list from the Humane Society, which we appreciated, of equipment that they believe to be theirs. And we have some dispute over a few of the equipment items because we purchased some of them. So we're going to, you know, identify what those are through our lawyer to their counsel, and we'll work on that stuff.
If the group or one commission contact me and let me know this is the same, I know you said November 6th, just in case something would happen and the deputy goes on a call down there, who's supposed to be where and who's not supposed to be where.
Right. And since Michelle is on the transition team too, she will know, you know, what the who to talk to when she's picked up animals or anything like that. But let me ask, hey Michael, what is the date the Humane Society actually has to leave the building based on the lease? I don't know if the 6th was the last day or the 5th was the last day.
The letter said the 10th.
The 10th? Okay, so the 10th. We're just wagging. I'm sorry. It broke a heart attack. So, yeah, we're just kind of trying to remember off the top of our heads. So the 10th is supposed to be your last day in the building. And that's when we had, so yeah, we'll get in there, make sure we have continuity of care. And that's what that team is for, to make sure those animals are getting, you know, that we know everything we need to know and that sort of thing. Yeah. That we're gonna be okay. So hopefully that team will assemble and meet very soon. I'll put somebody in charge of that. Kevin will get everybody. Kevin's here. I envision him leading that team. So he will, I'll get you all the contact information you need. And he'll put together the first meeting. The members of the transition team from the Humane Society, and I think also the new Humane Society, all have to meet at work. So just work through as far as, you know, making up your time for that. All right.
We'd like to do a transition meeting as soon as possible. We can keep the ball rolling.
Oh, I agree. If you can't do it this week, I mean, as early as possible next week. Because they've been doing a lot of work already, so they have a lot, and we've got Michael Taylor working on the equipment issue, so just to make sure, you know, and on things, you know, you guys might have to make some agreements on things that we own but don't need right now, we might want to buy or lease or whatever, so we just have to see what, you know, what the overall picture looks like. Okay. All right, okay, that's it with the Humane Society. Animal shelter. Can you guys think of anything else that I needed to cover? Okay, all right. We don't have anything till the public hearing. You want to do, right?
Yeah. Oh. Anthony wants to do
something. Oh, Anthony?
No, I'm just
going to
introduce you.
Oh, go ahead. We'll see that.
Yeah.
See that now, so she doesn't have to stay here. We've met before. Yeah.
This is Amy Laughlin. She's our newest assistant prosecuting attorney.
Congratulations. Do you ever want to talk about the differences between the two families? I can pick you up. I've practiced them both. They both have their pros and their cons. Strengths and weaknesses. Anyway, you went into a good office. You had a great boss. Yeah. I can tell you that. So I begged him to run for possibility. So anyway, nice to meet you. We're going to recess. It's 9:41. We'll be back at, let's get back at 9:55, so we're not late starting.
Sounds good.
I will see if I can reach out to Judge Eggers' clerk.
Reconvening at 9:58.
See if I can an answer as far as what
time. You have a 10 a.m. public hearing for rezoning case. Bradley Lohman, the case number is Z536-22-1. And it was postponed from last week because I am, the other commissioners have some additional questions. Angela, could you go ahead and just refresh us on it?
I don't think you have the map up on here that you guys know where it's at. So Mr. Lohman's property is currently rural residential out Lois Lane. It is legally ascribed to 6.29 acres. The Planning Commission, they did that, and their recommendation was to deny the rezoning. It is in front of you guys today to decide if you're going to accept their recommendation or if you're going to approve the rezoning.
Okay, I want to make a couple of statements, just general statements before we vote on this. One is I had some concerns because the chief advocate against the rezoning was the son of an elected official in this county. And I was concerned that somehow that might have influenced the vote of the Planning Commission. So I looked into it a little bit. I learned that the Planning Commission did vote unanimously, that there was no vacillating or waffling on anyone's part. And that while one member seemed to be a lot more interested and had a much stronger opinion than the others, all the opinions were consistent. I don't like the idea that our Planning Commission can be influenced by, you know, who they're related to, or by who, you know, somebody, an applicant is related to, or somebody in opposition of an applicant is related to. So I wanted to look into that just to make sure. I'm now confident and convinced that that did not influence the outcome. I think the outcome would have been the same had we, you know, had there been no elected official involved. So, and I'm not suggesting that official did it. I'm just saying that, you know, sometimes when you find that somebody's related to somebody, you're afraid to oppose what that person wants to do. One thing I do want to ask Angela that did concern me when I was asking you questions about this yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
When somebody puts out a petition and they get the neighbors to sign a petition about, I had Angela read me the petition that these neighbors, do you have a copy of it there? Okay. But I'll read it.
Yep.
So the petition just says, we strongly oppose changing the land classification on Lois Lane, and it has a zoning description, from residential to business tourism. Now, anybody who reads that is going to say, I'm signing it. You know, if you're a neighbor, you don't want a business by your residence. I think these petitions, I think we need to do whatever we have to do to change our rules.
So on that, the petition is voluntary. That's nothing in our zoning ordinance. What happens when an applicant comes to me, I send a letter to all the property owners within 250 feet. Saying what the public notice is. That is wording by the neighbors. I don't send that
okay,
out.
So
yeah, this has nothing to do with zoning. This is what the community filled out themselves.
Okay, so these are the names, but I mean, I feel like the people who are signing it need to understand what the proposal is.
Yeah, like I had nothing to do with that. They did that on their own.
So is this an informal thing?
That is informal by these residents.
Okay, so we don't typically accept petitions.
It goes in record just like evidence, basically. But we only are required to send notices to property owners within 200.
The ones that are affected, and they were sent copies of the proposal.
They were sent, no, the only thing they get sent is the copy of the public notice. And then it has my phone number if they have questions that they can contact my office asking, hey, what's this about? What does this person do?
So this is also pretty similarly vague, change land classification from rural residential to B3.
Yes.
So can we, or do we have to vote, or how can we get a copy of the proposal to the neighbors so they know what they're dealing with?
Because
they could think that he was trying to put a gas station in there.
It's kind of theirs. I mean, that's what code says, but I mean, if you guys want the expense of mailing the property owners within 250 feet,
that, I mean, that's up to you guys if you want to, because it would be basically this whole thing would go to them. That would be up to you guys. He typically just the ordinance says whatever the request is what gets mailed.
Could we post it online and provide them information where they can find it online?
We could if we had a website, but you asked also some of these people that have things they don't want their plan getting out there in case someone takes their plan.
Well,
I mean, we've had that in the past. People didn't want.
What if we just had a general description of what they want to change it to instead of, you know, and let the person submitting the application.
And I have in there, if they have questions, to contact me and I can email them more information.
Yeah, but I mean, sometimes it's a no-brainer, but if somebody said, okay, no, we're just talking about, you know, a handful of cabins or something like that.
I mean, we can. There's nothing against the ordinance.
In a residential neighborhood, that's a lot different than changing it to business and having, you know, a big...
Most neighbors historically have called and asked me, hey, I got this notice, what does it mean? And then I tell them what they're doing.
I would like to work with you to at least find a way on paper without sending the whole plan.
Yeah.
Make the plan accessible in your office. And
we can, I mean, we have the iWork software that I can upload all this to. And once we get our website up and going, that website is public where people can look at building permits. I can put it in there. I can scan it and basically do it that way. I mean, once we get a website, I can tell you, you can go to our county website and click on the case number and it'll.
At a minimum on the public notice of what we send the neighbors, maybe not in the paper because that'll cost more to publish, but on what we send the neighbors, I would like at least there to be a general description of what the plan is.
Yeah, that's fine. Like I said, this is just what the code's always told us we can do, but we can always go above and beyond.
What do you guys think about that?
I mean,
that's fine. Like I said, it's just what the code's always done, but I mean, we've got the software. I can say, if you'd like more details, click this link, and then they go to the website and look at their plan. And
I'd still like, even for those who don't want to click the link, just to put a little description, like, you know, campground, gas station, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
You know, just so they can decide whether they want to seek additional detail.
Okay. Sure.
You know, because right now, you know, you've got people, I don't want people suppressing growth just because they fear, you know, something by their property is going to get crazy. Because it is a big difference. You know, if I had a limited number of cabins in my house, I'd be okay with that compared to some major campground where there's going to be a bunch of RVs, a generator running and stuff.
But also, if he gets zoned B3, he can do anything that's allowed in that B3 district. So he can put cabins and campgrounds, and he could put a tourist shop. So you have to realize, when you get rezoned, anything that's in our Unified Development Code, you can do it.
So if somebody had a specific plan in mind and they wanted just to do something small,
that would be a plan development.
That would be a plan development.
Mm-hmm. But B3, when you rezone somebody B3, they're not limited to just cabins and campgrounds. They're limited to anything that's listed. And right now it's an artisan village, a gift shop, a marina. I know you're not going to put a marina out there, but that would be an option. So it would be anything.
And where, so how do you distinguish between a variance on the current rural residential versus the plan development?
So a variance is where it's not listed in our book at all. A variance is where someone wants to do something. For example, the drive-in theater in Oak Hill. We don't have a drive-in theater as a word in our UDC or Unified Development Code. Mm-hmm. So they had to apply for a variance because it's not listed. Cabins and campground is listed in a zone. So you need to rezone them for that. Plan development is when someone comes to me and they want a mix of something. They want a campground, but they also want an auto body shop. And they, like Wolf Creek Park was a very specific plan. Theirs is plan development because they had a lot of different things. So they, you have to stick by what your plan is. But B3, you're open to do anything that's listed in our B3, and I've got a list. So that's kind of the difference, but we could still list what their immediate plan is.
Well, I'll tell you, I think all three of us, I don't want to speak for them, but I think all three of us would like to have open transparency for everybody in the county so that they can look it up.
Sure.
We were getting letters, plan commission got letters from people who had lived nowhere near this property. I mean, you know, just who opposed vacation rentals in general and that sort of thing. And another thing I learned during this research process is that, and that concerned me, I wanted to tell you guys, is that apparently there's a lot of federal economic development money out there within banks to lend people who want to invest in projects like this. But because of restrictive zoning, a lot of that is being held up and as a result is going to get pulled back from the state by the feds because we're not able to spend it because we have so many rules that people can't develop here. And that's been a concern of ours, but I just wanted you to know, I knew about grants, but I didn't know that there were also like loan funds and matching and all that stuff out there that were being affected by it. That's something that worries me too for us. Like, I want to make sure we're not pushing people out. I mean, we have to consider the desires of people who live in these areas, obviously, because they've been here forever, but we also need to keep in mind that we don't want to get to a point where West Virginia doesn't have the availability of federal economic development funds because West Virginia has made it impossible for people to develop here.
Okay, I have one question on the 250 foot.
Mm-hmm.
Is it from the coordinates of the project or from the property
line? From the property line. Even if you own 20 acres and your thing's way over here and your neighbor, it's anybody within the property line. So that letter to
that if there's a project going on from around the property line,
mm-hmm.
250 foot, she has to notify them by a letter.
Yeah, and basically, I mean, what the code says is you send them a copy of the public notice.
Mm-hmm.
But like I said, we can always attach a sheet with a breakdown. I mean, that's up to you guys. It's just, yeah, I mean, whatever.
I think it would help. I mean, yeah. You know, when they were going around talking about a dog park in Fayetteville, you know, some people were for it and some people live too close to where they wanted to put it, you know, and didn't want a bunch of barking dogs. But I mean, people need to know what it is, I think, that's going in.
And a special use and a variance, it is listed. It says a single wide mobile home. It says, but in this, you're rezoning the whole property. So
if somebody wanted, I guess what I'm saying is, if you wanted to mitigate the fear, if you had something small in mind and you wanted to mitigate the fear that the person could go anyway, you know, like you said, you rezone a commercial, do whatever you want. If you wanted to assure people, like, look, I'm not going to do that, what kind of zoning is, so it's not a variance, would it be a special use?
It's only a special use if it's listed as a special use item in our book. Our book has very specific items that are special use. For example, if you want to put a mobile home in the county, you have to go through a special use because anything less than 20 foot wide, you have to get approval through the Board of Zoning Appeals, not the Planning Commission. So the book that was created 20 years ago very specifically says what is rezoning or what is a special use.
Well,
and that is something that we hopefully need to update our
PC,
but
that because I mean we're going to have a need for that because we want development, but we also don't want, if somebody wants to put in something small and everybody's scared, they might approve if they knew there were constraints on it. But you know, we're just doing a free-for-all, you know, all or nothing.
Yeah, and I mean that's what rezoning is sometimes. It's so wide because once you rezone this property to B3, then he could put a gift shop if he wanted, just the way that it's written. So, but you have to realize the book's 20 years old, so it does need to be updated, in my opinion, but it's also very costly. Town of Fayetteville just spent a lot of money to update theirs. So.
Yeah, that's why we need our comprehensive plan so that we can redo the UGC on a lot of different
levels. Yeah, I agree. And I have also learned that there are people who aren't following the rules and are just putting homes on their properties and creating campgrounds and things without going through zoning, and they're being rewarded by us not enforcing them.
Right.
Yeah. So we need to have a follow-up conversation about that because we don't want selective enforcement. So basically, you abide by the rules, the message we're sending is, you know, you're likely to get turned down, and if you're not abiding by the rules, you can do whatever you want. You know, so Rod, we're going to be meeting with y'all about some of this.
And Anthony.
Learning about,
And Anthony,
yeah. I've got specifics in my mind that I don't plan to list right now. So with regard to Mr. Lohman's application, based on everything I've said, we tend to go with the recommendation of the Planning Commission. And since I do not now believe that they were unduly influenced, I'm going to move that we deny or accept the Planning Commission's recommendation.
Second.
All those in
favor? Aye. Aye.
Sorry.
So I do want to let, since the neighbors are here, so his property is 6 acres. The way that our ordinance says, you can have one unit per 2 acres. So if he chooses, he can still build 3 cabins. So if anybody sees him building the 3 cabins, that is within the statute. So, and also he can reapply in a year, or he can appeal the decision. So I just have to make that required to say. So. Yeah.
Okay. Have a building permit.
And have a building permit, but he's aware of that. So
yeah, and you know, maybe after the 3 year up and show that there's not a huge influx of people coming in and out, we might be able to convince more people to come along to your side on that.
I just want to let everybody know that he can. So if there is construction, he decides to do that. Cabins, we don't really consider them cabins, they're residential structures, because there's always that opportunity that someone moves in it, so that is an option. Okay.
All righty. We have Mike on here in the middle.
Right there he is.
I know, but I was just, normally we try to go into executive session at the end.
Well, because we don't know how long the last one will last for the presentation.
Okay.
I'm flexible.
Oh,
I didn't say that.
That's okay. I know I didn't either.
Slip in on me,
Mike. All right, then. I think at this time I need to move that we go into executive session to consult with counsel about the hazmat spill litigation. That's what we're here about, right, Mike?
Right.
All right, so 10:15, let's end in there. And let's try to get back out here.
Have fun. So have fun. Oh, and I we got this in right now.
Right now,
yeah.
So,
if you want to.
I don't want to walk
that far. Far. So, we had our time for matter. I just went in. I was going to take it in there and then do. There are lots of times going in with me.
So maybe we're talking different. Look, so there is a mod.
Back on the record at 10:57, we had advice from legal counsel about the hazmat spill, the litigation we have going on, made no decisions. And now we're going to do the Spillman presentation first. Spillman up here, you want to do it?
Okay.
That way, since we're a little bit behind on that.
Thank you so much for the opportunity to be here this morning. My name is Mike. I'm with Motorola Spillman Flex. You guys have been a customer of ours for 9-10 years now on our CAD, our records, and mobile software. So grateful to be here today. I know there's a lot of questions regarding where we are with the software, how we're doing on upgrades, et cetera, and where we need to be at. Sounds like there's a little disconnect on maybe some data that needs to be put within the software so we can make these specific upgrades. I don't expect you to remember this, but when you signed a contract, I believe it was 2013, all of our updates and upgrades are built within the pricing of your annual maintenance contract. So there is annual maintenance contract that you guys pay, but you are able to have these upgrades on a, I guess, a routine basis or when they become available. It sounds like there's maybe, we fell a little bit behind on our GIS mapping. We are on a legacy map right now, which has limitations, right? It fit within the software, but it's got some limitations. There's surrounding counties that are on the ArcGIS mapping integration that we would love to get you to that point. And so there's some work ahead, and we'll have some additional proposals that will come your way just to get you to that level. So that's just a little bit of background of where we're at today and what we're trying to accomplish. As part of the presentation, we figured it would be a great opportunity. I'll have Philip drive here, but we're here to answer questions, question answers you guys might have. Through the software, what it's designed to do. We've had a lot of growth in the state. Just want to let everybody know that there's surrounding counties that currently have the software. There are the state police has signed up with us, and they've been live for just under 2 years. And there is data sharing capability that you currently don't have today. Now, that data sharing capabilities is within the software, and it shares data between all Spillman Flex users. So it's unfortunate that you were one of the first, or if not the first in the state. That was not set up when we first started this insight, is what it's called, the data sharing capabilities. Fast forward to today, for the last 4 or 5 years, this feature has been available in the state. The server actually lives in Jefferson County. So essentially, when you run a query within the software, you can run the NCIC query and be able to search not only wants, warrants, et cetera, from that individual, but then you can search the database and you know more information who has run into other counties or specifically the state police. And that's, again, something that we'll present a proposal price to get you added on to that. But that is working today and very officer safety related, knowing who you're dealing with and people send the deal or dealing with an individual. So with that being said, I'm not sure what kind of questions that you have, but as presented up on the screen here, you'll see this is our legacy mapping, which is built within the software. So there's a much more sophisticated mapping, but we've got to reach that point. So there's some ESRI-based mapping that needs to be updated and some work that has to be done in order to get you to the new mapping. But the idea is you have the ABL automatic vehicle locator is what it's pronounced by, is a way for seeing those officers on the map and being able to know how to dispatch and how to get them to the appropriate incident in a timely manner. So
I want to make sure that I heard you correctly. And yeah, that's an inside joke with everybody. I just got hearing devices. So you stated that all of these upgrades are going to come to us in time, but there's no additional cost because it's part of our annual maintenance.
Correct.
How come we're so far behind?
So a lot of this has to do with where you are with the data that's in the ESRI system. So in order to make this mapping work, you have to be able to input all of the coordinates within the mapping system, and then our system will then talk to the GIS mapping process. So you're not up to speed on where you need to be level wise to get us to that point. So no upgrades can happen without that information.
Okay. So our ESRI, as you called it, was not updated as it should have been.
Correct. We do have a plan to get you to that point. We will present a proposal prior to your next commission meeting and get you some pricing on what that would be. And Motorola Spillman will be able to do all the work that's associated to get you that level.
Okay, so Spillman is owned by Motorola?
Correct.
And that's why you're only recommending using Motorola units in all the vehicles.
No, our system can talk to multiple products, but in 2016, Motorola acquired Spillman, and we still utilize the name Spillman and run. This is a software that's a no end of life software, so it's just continuing being enhanced. And this was a purchase you made in 2013 that will be around for a very, very long time. That Motorola will continue. So it is owned by Motorola, and you may or may not seen any changes associated with it, those users that use the software, other than enhancements.
Commissioner has nothing to do with our radios or car. It's all internet based.
Okay.
Server wise, it goes to the server and hits our laptop in our car. He has nothing to do with like radio yet in the car.
Thank you.
We'll see the updating. I'm not pointing fingers at anybody, but the system has been put on the side with updates and stuff like that that's been needed the last probably 4 or 5 years, maybe longer. We haven't even had a GIS coordinator to map stuff. I mean, if you're talking about bringing the mapping up to scale, and then our GIS GM is doing.
Yeah,
she works. There you go. She would still manage
it. Yeah, I am currently working on fixing areas, especially the ones that are zeroed out and correcting their addresses, and different ones that come in on a day-to-day basis. For Hattiesville area, one road that has come to a road, for example, that wasn't correct, and I corrected them. Just finished up the fire map, and we are working on the EMS stuff to do the areas.
Yeah, and this is a process, and you can probably attest to that. It's not an overnight process, no. Right? It is a long, tedious, lot of work, it would take you a lot of time to get this up and running. And I think that's where we would be able to help with that, right, and be able to get you to that level. But then you would also need to continue to update and do the daily, day-to-day things. So it's not a one-time fix, and here we go. It's a continuous GIS support approach.
Right.
Our proposal that will be coming would get you to that point where we can upgrade the mapping, and then it would be handed off to continually take care of all the data that gets put in the software.
Right.
So into the Esri software that right. then communicates within the Flex software.
And I feel like that after it's all not completed, but up to date enough to publish and, you know, change over, a weekly update should be sufficient.
And she can probably use updates every day. But,
I mean, absolutely.
Depending on the information, when we go to Raleigh County, I think that what they were talking about, but it's coming in, they could update within 24 hours or 12 hours or something, depending on what it was, going out and checking, make sure the coordinates is right, and mapping it and coming back. Yeah, so it's something that we got, but it's an ongoing process.
It's a never ending process.
And been involved with learning it. It's just it's an ongoing process that you'll always have to update things continually.
Absolutely, absolutely. But I think the key is these upgrades are available and they're there for you and they have been. We just got to get you to that level.
The data.
We've got to get that data in the system to get you into that next upgrade. But, as I mentioned before, these upgrades are built within your maintenance contract. So on an annual basis, you are paying a maintenance contract for the upkeep of the software, for all the support that's associated with it. But also it includes all of this, these upgrades. And so you may have fallen behind, but they're available and you will schedule that when you're available and ready to do that. So we're not coming forward with additional, this platform that you are using today is going to be a platform that's around for a very, very long time. So we're not asking for additional funds to put you on a new platform. We just want you to get to a level where it can be supported for those new updates that come out. That's where we need to get to now.
What will the increase in functionality be when we pick them up to the current standard?
So it's a very sophisticated mapping system where it's going to pinpoint all incidents on the map. You have the AVL, you currently have the AVL, if I remember correctly, which is automatic vehicle locator. So dispatch, as well as officers, can see units in the field and know where they are specifically. That is a safety measure, especially if there's an incident where it causes, maybe there's some altercation or anything like that, if the officer have protection for the officer. It's not officer safety, knowing where they are and where they're located and making sure that they're, you know, radioing in saying they're okay. Right, dispatch having an eye on it. So you'll have that information and be able to track them on the map, but it is a much more sophisticated map that can do a lot more things. You'll be able to put layers on there for the layers would include fire hydrants, different obstacles that can be added into it, road closures, weather issues. I mean, you name it, that it will have those capabilities. So if there's an incident and there's a road that's down, then the officer can get there in a timely manner by knowing which routes to take.
The hydrants are on there now. We just recently updated those.
That's great. And that's very helpful for fire, right? To know what they're doing.
Our department ran that building. All that's on there. I mean, we do our little papers, we do civil on everything, even civil processing through school. So that thing's got all kinds of options in it that we can utilize in the fire end. And when Phil and PC and all that stuff, maybe Phil or your nephew at the sheriff's office, he was our field guy. And I mean, we was, what would you call it? We was the pilot program to say what you mean with Phil. And we would reach out to all these other counties and they jumped on board. And I'm going to kind of summarize it before you. They was way more advanced in their mapping than we were. That's why they are ahead of us, because we built our mapping for them.
Well, we passed back when we purchased in 2014, the ARC server, what he's talking about, their mapping wasn't even a thing.
Right.
So we were kind of stuck in this legacy world. And then as they bought their server, they bought ARC with it.
Yes.
It was purchased with
it. But I think we're getting more closer up to where we need to be on our mapping situation and to be able to progress with it.
Does anybody have any questions? If we're all stalemate right here, let me be quiet for
a second, please. Yeah.
That's why I asked him to come in today. Answer any questions for the staff or anybody else that wants to ask a question.
So the proposal of the year is going to grant to the commission. They're expecting to assist updating the PI.
Correct. As well as our module called Insight, which is the ability to talk with other counties and along with state police on data sharing capabilities. So as a pilot program that we mentioned, you were the first in the state that signed up with this built in flex software. And those capabilities were not available because there was no other customers. Now we have multiple counties and multiple jurisdictions that are using the software with that ability to share the data with other surrounding counties and state police. And that all has to be dialed into a server, which is in Jefferson County. And it's seamless. You wouldn't even know where, it doesn't matter where that server is, but you run a query on an individual. And so the proposal would be also to include that data sharing thing. So
it's just a module. Like if I read Rob Purdue's school. I'm interested in all counties. It's all pumped up with all my particulars again to the zone places in the city. All my information. It's shared throughout whoever's got Spillman. I speed up the progress. Plus, we can look at his background. Bruce Spillman said running a trip wide now that he's another offender.
Yeah. So that would include in our proposal as well, just to get you to more of an officer safety approach on that. it's just the more information you have, the better the officer will be.
You mentioned something about the system already having a training program in or a training, like Google training program. Did anybody here know that? Yeah. You know that?
There is. There's, we were talking about that earlier. You talked about training for the, you know, like the CAD administration and all that. That's, you know, actual platform training in Schaumburg. But there is some online courses there that are actually free to us being a contract customer. That's correct.
Yeah, it is. It's built within the software. It's
like called. If any of the CAD users want to do some online stuff, I can log them in and take online courses.
In other words, we can set up online courses with the dispatchers or anybody we want to have courses. That's something that I didn't know whether you that had the ability to do that. Time,
yeah.
Okay.
It's actually just a redirect. It's depending on the Motorola's learning.
Okay.
So how long has that been available?
It's been quite a while since. I don't know the exact dates.
But
it's a free service, and it's within the software. And, it, and the idea for that is we don't expect you to remember everything. And so there's going to be questions that come up and say, oh, how do I do this or how do I do that? Well, there's a way to get that detailed information on how to kind of refresh that memory and be able to utilize the software how it needs to be used.
Is there a list of courses in which they can take off of this training or step by step?
There is, yes.
Tanja, has that been incorporated into the training?
It hasn't.
I would suggest getting that incorporated into the training.
Not saying Commissioner Williams is asking me about responsible units when I sign the calls. Who the responsible unit would be and if we was next available after that. That's something that was kicked around once before. Can you elaborate on that? About the responsible unit?
As far as the response plans, yes, but built in. Let me ask you a question. Do you have response plans within your software?
I don't think it's in there.
Okay. So that might be something that we can evaluate and look into. So within the software, there are modules that you can purchase into.
Yeah, it'll only be for like EMS and fire, not law enforcement. It's really for those.
Does that come from the software that you like I put it in the table, like an attribute table, and put it here, and I just put comments. And
yeah, it won't be able to pull that for an incident. But what the response plans would do is if there's a structured fire, and you need a specific engine for this structured fire, so you would tell the system what in this scenario. Who would I send? It will automatically do a recommended unit for that incident. So if there's a specific structured fire, you need a ladder, you need a tanker, whatever the situation is, you would pre-set up these recommended units. And it will pull number one recommended unit, but also number two closest unit at that point.
So you're talking about the mutual aid agreement program that would be very good. Encapsulated in the program that way, we'll just say Fayetteville gets tuned to. So we know that Fayetteville and Anstead covers Chestnutburg Road. Instead of saying, well, we don't know where it's at, it'll populate Anstead, Fayetteville.
That's what it is. What I see is Rollins County, and even Rollins County, even though they don't need this building, they're just set up the same way just about. And you can pre program that system any way you want to program it. So then the dispatcher can see what's going on, but she can just push a button and it'll automatically send
it. Yeah. It would all be based off of the individual departments agreed upon mutual agreements between the fire chiefs and departments.
And that doesn't have to be as complicated as we can make out, because all they need to know is which station they don't want to have to talk.
Correct.
The departments know what to send.
Well, he's just saying you can make it fine,
but you're right. It would help the dispatchers respond quickly without memorizing.
Right.
Where do I pull this from? Right. It's the bottom of the
department. So what to say in that particular situation. So I mean, this could be.
Yeah. So this is. It could be said. Yeah. So this is just like Raleigh counties, and I've seen Raleigh counties in action. So they know in this designated area that they mapped off, it's going to be station 102, 103, 104.
and it don't say what engine this in, it just says that station.
Yeah.
So you know if an address pops up within that geographical area, you want to send department A, B, and C.
Right.
And then those departments will decide on what recommended units that they're going to send from the department.
Right.
Instead of us saying, all right, station 3, or engine 36, engine 32, we're not going in for metro dispatch. We're just saying this is the station that's going to go.
We cannot even implement this until we get our
right
matching.
Correct. Right. But
it's a step by step protocol. The reason it is, these fire zones, through info
yes.
Now, it will be fighting the crew from the final zone.
Yes.
All right.
Correct.
So that would revamp these zones, we'd be able to utilize that for them.
Still, even remapping, you've got to enter other data on who,
right.
You know, who
the zones would be revamped too. Yeah.
Well, I think the zones is, I think we've already got the zones map.
Yeah.
But there's other information we need from
the law enforcement side. It's almost impossible to do one for people. Because you don't know what that unit is actually going on that location. He might be on an investigation.
Yep.
And it's just the way it is. You cannot do that on law enforcement.
It's almost it'll have
to go. So the only thing you could do for the police department is on having county. And then each city, you know, that's it. That's all we
can do. Yeah,
that's that was what Kevin talked about. That's what I've been talking about from the very time I got out there.
And that's why
making that system user friendly to the dispatcher to make everything more time efficient, make everything more efficient. And the data needs to be entered. There needs to be agreement. The data entered. Put it in to make it simple.
You know, you have your map up. So, you see here, there's an incident of this animal problem that's documented on there. If that was a fire, just say like a structure fire, and that area is zoned out, and that address is populated, and it's in within that certain zone, it would pop up and say station 102, 103, 104. Those are your responsible stations that would respond there. Those is when the dispatchers would know those are the stations that you tone out. No questions asked. That's what goes.
Well, really, Tim, you wouldn't have to just push the button and then automatically tone them out.
Right. But it's got to be programmed. It's all yeah, that'll be programmed. Yeah. Things that'll be programmed. But that'd be the response unit. So we know that. So each one of these areas is a different meaning. So we know that's right here. So then we'll just say that this is, we'll say Fayetteville, Anstead, or Fayetteville, Anstead, and Oak Hill. Or, yeah. You see how they're.
We've got them zoned out.
Yeah.
We're in different zones.
Yes.
And we can work within
those. Yes, you can work within those zones and say, okay, this is what we want, this is how we want it. The data can be given, the data can be programmed into it, and then when the address pops up through the alley and any screen and populates on the map, then therefore the stations show up who goes on that call.
Same for EMS, too.
Same for EMS.
Primary track and secondary
track. Yep. Yeah.
It's the progress I've ever seen.
If Fayetteville EMS units aren't available, then you have secondary, you know, so your secondary EMS unit is, which will either be 205 at East End or 407 at 1960.
That part, the most time consuming part of any map is putting what area is surrounding. That is the most time consuming part. Every other thing falls in the box when it's printed.
Okay. I can tell you, Donna has literally been sitting at her desk and she had calling on the geocoded and everything, and I walked in her office one day and she had maps plastered all over the office.
They're everywhere.
And what would you all, Matt, what will you all, when you're talking about this money to do this for the system, what will you all exactly map?
All coordinates,
okay.
Housing, fire hydrants,
okay.
All the layers that are associated with it. It's an uplift. It's a lot of work.
Oh, yeah.
All of the addresses, all the streets, all the all the requirements, right?
That's right.
You're doing on a daily basis.
What if someone engineer comes to our office and sit and work side by side with us building this, particularly off site? Because I know sometimes an engineer will come in and help build these things, but sometimes they're off site as well.
So most of the time it's off site. They can remote in and do it off-site, which that's the technology, right? It's kind of that ability. If you wanted something on-site, well, the only cost associated with that is the time of sending it.
And we do have one issue, and I'm glad Benny's here because it's in his area. Not to pick on Benny, nothing against you. But we do have a problem with some addressing in the valley.
Yeah.
And what I wanted to do is, since Benny, it's your area, you would get to go to all these houses and you would try to talk them in to get it more cordial with the addressing.
Is this a matter of individuals that actually live there?
Yeah.
I mean, mine is true though. I mean, Val and I talked about that. But I live at one address, there's another address, and then Apples has another address.
Well, the mapping address is supposed to use that. I don't know whether you can speak on this, but the mapping address, and correct me if I'm wrong, either one of y'all, mapping address you're supposed to use when you, I think, send letters or talk to some of the residents down there, it is a fight.
Yeah.
About utilizing certain addresses. Now, do you have any problems with that, or how do you think? What do you suggest to solve that?
I wish I had those answers, but I do not. I don't personally build the GIS coordinates mapping, so I've never come across that.
So there's
what was recommended at one time was sort of the commission to hold a community a meeting in those communities and explain the reasoning behind the 911 mapping process. We don't care what billing address they use, as long as the numbers of the 911 system match what's on the house.
Well, I was going to ask you, does it even matter today with GIS, the way the mapping is today, if somebody calls from that location and you have it mapped or at that a certain address, whether they're using a different address, and they're using will it just take them to that location?
It will, because it's taking a call. This is going to be through call taking software, but it will take a longitude call and pinpoint where that call's coming from, whether that's a cell phone or a
satellite. So it really doesn't matter if they don't agree with what address we give them as a 911 emergency address. Is that correct?
Correct. Yeah, because it's pulling that long anyway for the call. So they have nowhere of this incident.
So that way, Don, it probably wouldn't be a big deal is what he's saying. As long as you mapped it,
right,
and you got the coordinates for that location,
right,
whatever address we had for it, and everybody knows what's for it on the system, who cares what they use?
Yeah.
I mean, that was one of my questions.
Yeah.
I got an address in Montgomery, 16 Fayette Pike. Diana and I both talked about this. It's like 21271 deep water mountain.
Right.
Is there a way we can actually layer both of those addresses so that if the old lady that lives there calls us,
I can
put
them on the pack and the table on the entry end, put in the comment, this house is using this address. Like if I went up to Campbell and the J-Ray. And hey, they're using J62. And
if, I mean, that would be a lot more simpler in the effect. Like I said, there's, you know, in Adena buildings alone, there is no consistency or anything.
So as long as we map them on the map, and we know where it's at, and everybody knows, but okay, so that's not
correct.
A problem. Okay, I wanted to talk about that a little bit.
Yeah,
it's the problem if we could today, because it's.
Yeah, your landline that goes to your phone companies, when a call comes in, it shows up your alley and annie, which will give you at least the latitude and longitude of what the phone company has already programmed in. When the cell phone rings in, it's based off of the triangulation of the closest nearest tower that will put you within so many miles of where that cell phone is ringing at. So you can pick up your phone and dial from here, and it may hit a tower that's over in Lansing, or it may hit a tower that's in Mount Hope. But you'll still get that triangulation of a certain geographical area that will put you within so many miles of that ping of that cell phone.
And that's through your call taking software, which is not Spillman Flex, just so everybody knows.
After the software is upgraded, will our officers be able to tie in, or how will we be able to tie in all of our communications towers? instead of having to go from area to area.
That's a total different project.
Okay. So the software does not fix that issue.
This is your call taking software and your records management. Your radio equipment is a total different animal. Just like that. So you got your call taking software, your call answering software, which is your phone system, and your radio. So you've got three different programs that is running.
All right.
Yes.
So now we talk about the employee data.
Yeah.
We talked about that earlier. Basically, to get that to work, they would have to manually say the law once they log in, they just have to come in and make a log in. But there's no way to make that automatically happen. They physically have to go into that employee table and put themselves in the duty.
So, really?
Yeah, instead of when they log in.
Yeah, it's not automatic. They can go through the employee table and you can log it that way.
Was there any way you can get a printout of the time that they log in and the time that they didn't log in to show? I'm trying to solve a payroll problem. The time they logged in to the time they logged out, and use that as a hours. It's got to show.
It's here's the best part about software: any data in can be pulled out, and so it is logging when you do log in. But how do we pull that data is going to be the biggest question.
Right? Well, that's big.
There's reports that can be, there are already. And reporting within the software that there might be something already there, or we could, we could build any reports. The best part is anybody that built reports, other agencies in the whole nation are available within our software. So there might be something already. I don't know.
Can you check and see? And even if it's you can check and see what's available, because that's the issue out there. It'd make it a lot easier for everybody. We'll know when somebody was there, when they wasn't there. I'm not saying anybody. I mean, it's just attempt to know what's going on out there. It's part of the payroll, so we can keep up with it.
Absolutely.
Ruth, you want to tell me anything special you want to maybe open his eyes?
Yeah.
Okay, you got your 2 cents already. You better get more than two cents. Yeah, it does
like,
have
like that.
Yeah, it does have that. I mean,
that
was a,
that lucky.
But that's just for vacation.
Yeah, that's not what we got last night. Yeah. So what you showed is good.
What's that doing in there for if it doesn't keep track of all this? What is that in there for, Chris?
They can go in here, I think, go to the industry, go to ads, and they can put a code in there. For their time when they come in, and then they go there again when they go out, and then that goes in.
So you
but if they ain't all that and log in, they ain't gonna do it.
It is very manual process. I think what they're trying to alleviate is how we get rid of this manual process to log in on.
See, and they have to log off, right? They have to, some kind of code, they have to turn it off, the log in, they have to log out. So that's the way to keep up with the time, in my opinion.
Yeah. Is there anything else?
Any more questions, John?
No, first, thank you for coming and see us.
Thank you for the opportunity. We appreciate it. Thank you for your business. We really appreciate it.
And I can see what Commissioner Lewis has been saying, that we need to get our systems updated on the inside, and that's where we're going to rely on Philip an awful lot too.
You guys have any questions? I see a lot of our members out there. You guys have any questions for him?
No, I'm glad y'all stuck around for this. It was mainly for everybody, but I'm glad y'all stuck around.
Yeah, thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
Alrighty, let's move on to our last item of the day. And that is the 911 changes and recommendations. Our 911 center director resigned effective Monday, 17th, we have a need to appoint an interim director, and I was just going to ask Mr. Lewis who he recommends since he's been working out there.
Following the end of the month.
Okay. You willing to be interim director?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So I move that we appoint Tanya McMillan. Are we doing Tanja or Tanya? This is a long standing issue.
It's Tanja. I'm sorry.
Mullen.
That's so right. That's so right.
Listen, it took me years to figure out her name.
You need to spell that one out. He didn't have any room left. But
I
mean,
I have two sheets up here for it already.
So, Andre McMullen.
McMullen.
To be interim director of Fayette County 911 Center effective today.
Okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
I also think we need to advertise for a new director, but I feel like, and Tanya, obviously, you're welcome to talk to that. But I think we need to work on the position description a little more and get it on the agenda for the second. Okay. And at that time, we can deal with the fire coordinator position, which is also outstanding. And Commissioner Lisa still work with the fire association working group to come up with that position description as well. Is there anything?
I have something. Oh, not on that. I have something about 911.
Okay, good.
Kevin, while we have people here, can you please give us an update on the status of the tower that's going in the valley?
Built. Yeah, built.
All in the valley?
Yeah.
Yeah, I just did get the air quality coming back to the meeting yesterday. They just finished the environmental, and that's wrapping up. The last thing was generator for the industry. Just got that yesterday. So now everything's cleared. They've done the core drills, they've done all that. So now we're actually cleared to break ground. So I got to get the contractor to say, okay, you know, touch the ground, do what you need to do, and actually start the demolition of the old site before the new one's built. So they got to tear down the fence, the old tower. Like we've got to do some road work down there.
So they're not leaving the other tower up, they are taking it down.
Well, no, now our existing is on the top.
Okay.
This is an old Verizon tower, real old site. That's what they got to take down.
Okay.
For that for the new work. But so it's not going to harm our community down there because we're not touching it. It's 300 feet away.
Okay.
That's kind of where we're at. It's just this geo took so long. Environmental. It's
all. Yeah.
One of the biggest holdups was, I've never seen it happen, was they wanted an air emission quality test done for a generator.
Yep.
For an on-site generator, they required us to do an air quality monitoring study to see what the emissions were. And if it hadn't been for that, it would have been held up. But
it turns out we got the lead. Like I said, I got to do people check at the end of the day.
We're not even required
to have any kind of waiver or anything, so we waited for all that just to get sent a letter saying that we're not getting it.
But then I still have to post that letter at the site.
Yeah,
the site goes, and we have to have the record.
And then make sure that you do it before the leather wing bats come back too.
Yes. Yeah, so that's kind of where we're at.
Okay, so we have two other items from the exhibit list. With regard to Dan Hilton's salary, we hadn't voted move that we hire him at $30,000. We're offering him $30,000 a year.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Don't have a start date yet. He needs at least 2 weeks' notice, so I just say we have to bring him on as soon as possible after that. Also, tip for Wolf Creek Park, we don't have an answer from Don Stump yet about the timing of that. We just need to remove it. Need to figure out when to remove it, because we're obviously not going to transfer it to the new purchaser. So I'm going to move that we postpone that to November 2nd. Michael Taylor is supposed to talk to John Scott this afternoon about it. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Okay. Is there any other business?
No.
I have one thing.
Okay.
Kevin's got one thing before I do.
For our experience with transition, is Mr. Baylor going to be available for that? I know that he said he would like to be available for that meeting.
Yes. Do you have his contact?
I think I will ask about that. Okay. It's a meeting that will have to involve him.
Okay. I would also like to add that nationally, over the last week, there's been a lot of talk about police, fire, ambulance, hospitals. I personally, with my own opinion, feel that our first responders need to be treated like heroes and not like villains. So hats off from me to you guys for everything that you do, whether you're police, fire, working in the 911 center, you guys all do a good job. So thank you.
Thank you. All right, anything else, anybody? Appreciate all y'all coming. All right, we're done.